Well, wouldn't you know it, there's a new Foo Fighters album out. I haven't really talked about this band much, but that is something I hope to remedy in the near future. So for those who don't know, Foo Fighters are an American rock band that combine elements of hard rock, post-grunge, and alternative rock to create a really loud and aggressive sound that they are one of the best examples of. Many will recognise frontman Dave Grohl as the former drummer of the popular grunge band Nirvana, and essentially Foo Fighters is kind of like the spiritual successor to them, with a much more alternative, mainstream and hard rock flair to them. They've been going for over 20 years now, and ever since their creation they remain one of the biggest rock bands that is working today, and have sold over 12 million albums over in the US alone. And while personally I was very late into getting into the band, the minute I listened to their Greatest Hits album, they quickly became one of my all-time favourite bands, right up there with Muse and Green Day. I love albums by them like their debut, Colour in the Shape, and Wasting Light, and while not as good as those three, I still thoroughly enjoyed both There Is Nothing Left to Lose and One by One. I'll admit that 2005's In Your Honor was a bit of a step backwards for the band, and I haven't even listened to Sonic Highways at the time this video's upload, but they're still consistently bringing out great material. And the album they have presented to us this year is Concrete and Gold. So yes, for those who are wondering, I did indeed purchase Concrete and Gold the day it came out. But not without some hesitation. Now I still remain as optimistic as possible when I hear about things I'm not sure on, but even I was quick to raise an eyebrow when Dave announced that they had brought in Greg Kurstin, a guy who primarily specialised in pop music with artists like Lily Allen, Adele and Kelly Clarkson, was the producer of the album. Now look, I'm not trying to have a go at him, I'm sure he's a very nice guy and that he's good at his job, but it did make me wonder what he would do with a rock band rather than a pop artist. Then I found out that he actually co-wrote and produced the track Wall of Glass by Liam Gallagher, and that did make me cautiously optimistic for what we would do with this album. I'll get into why I think about that later. So I went out and ordered the album, and then I couldn't listen to it because I was too busy with schoolwork. But once I had the free time, I popped it on and gave it a listen. I mean, at the very least, I expected it to just be another One by One. 6 or 7 memorable tracks that everyone likes, the rest just filler. So, how'd it turn out? It's alright. It's certainly not the best work they've ever done, but on the other hand, it's not terrible. I did more or less guess correctly with it being a little bit like another One by One, but not entirely. I think they got a bit more experimental with this album, as there are elements of progressive rock that get thrown into this album, but I digress. I guess I'll first get into the tracks that I liked. It should come at no surprise that the lead single from this album, Run, is still really good and one of my favourites. I love the way the track starts off really quietly, that makes you think it's going to be a really quiet song, before it just explodes into the choruses with the heavily distorted guitar line and vocals. The instrumentation is pretty good throughout the track, and the track just builds into a very simplistic but very effective guitar solo. Production wise, I have no issue here, but what brings this track down are the lyrics. The lyrics are kinda terrible, to be brutally honest. They feel very meaningless, and half the time you can't tell what he's saying because of the distort feature during the verses. The song is also pretty repetitive, with the same lines and sections repeated over and over again. Like seriously, if you want to play a drinking game, take a shot every time they say the word run in the song. You will die. But solid track nevertheless. Another one of my favourite tracks is La-Di-Da. La-Di-Da? Seriously? Anyway, this one focuses much more on the bassline during the verses and features a more groovy, almost dance-centric beat that works surprisingly well. The choruses are really good and the fighter-style distorted vocals work much better on here than they do on Run. I really, really like this track, and the more I listen to it, just the better it seems to get. I mean, I know a total like La-Di-Da might turn some people away, but trust me, it's a great time. The only real negative I have is that at times the track does feel a little overproduced, mostly during the choruses, although that might be to blame because of the mixing and not the production, but next. Arrows is a great song. This one features a slightly different time signature, very much like Miss the Misery from Wasting Light, and it uses that to its advantage. This is where the progressive elements that I mentioned before come into play, as the track Light Run starts off very quietly but gradually builds and then drops into an incredibly satisfying chorus that may be simplistic but is no less enjoyable. Dave's vocals are also fantastic on this track, balancing the mature, quiet moments with the bombastic vocals in the chorus. The guitar solo is also perfect. It feels like it was born to be played on this track, and the instrumental parts remind me a lot of their track Wheels that was on their Greatest Hits album. So while it's not my favourite track on the album, that Arno I will talk about later, it's a definite highlight and a grower for me. Another fun time is track 10, The Line. This one feels the most classic Foo Fighters sounding, with the upfront guitar during moments and the vocals during the chorus. It feels very In Your Honoury, like it fit very well into the first disc of that album. Not a whole lot to say about it. It may be quite short, but it doesn't overstay its welcome like many other tracks on the record. And Make It Right is also pretty good. Despite me feeling that it lacks in some areas and its unusual structure might throw you off guard, it's made up for with some great drumming and vocals. But far and away my favourite track on it has to be Sunday Rain. This is an excellent song. What is super cool about this track is that Taylor Hawkins, the drummer for this band, sings on this track, and I have to say, he does a great job. He sounds a little bit like a more softer and more melodic Dave, and considering that this and Cold Day in the Sun are the only songs he sings lead on, and he does a great job on both, just makes me think, come on Dave, give Taylor a little love. But I digress. This track is a much slower, almost ballad style of a track, very much like the Beatles, and it reminds me a little bit of Push Comes to Shove by Van Halen. I love the bassline in this track, and the drums from Taylor are really— wait, Paul McCartney play the drums on this track?
My life is complete!
But anyway, the only real negative is that while I love the song, it does maybe drag on a bit too long for its own good at 6 minutes, making it the longest track on it. But with great instrumentation, an engaging chorus, great vocals, and production that works very well, this is my favourite track on here. Unfortunately, for tracks that I really like slash love, that's where the sound just kind of ends for me. The rest of the track are not bad per se, though a couple may fall into that category, and some are pretty decent, but they are just pretty forgettable and just do not do much for me. Dirty Water has a more laid back and relaxed feel, similar to There Is Nothing Left to Lose, and there is some nice instrumentation with the acoustic guitars that transfer into electric, but the song just seems to drag on way too long for its own good, and the lyrics like Run could get very repetitive and boring towards the end of the track. Happy Ever After Zero is decent and has some very nice vocals and acoustic guitar elements, but the track really feels like it's lacking something to really push it to the next level. The title track Concrete and Gold feels incredibly Pink Floyd inspired, with its slow tempo and grand epicness feel, and while I admire the inspiration and ambition, the track as a whole just really doesn't compare to anything Pink Floyd have done. The chorus feels way too slow, even for a Pink Floyd style song, and that just makes the song feel like it's trying too hard to be better than Floyd, so it just cranks the guitar feedback up to 11 and blasts you for an overly long period. Ugh, I'm sorry, this track just doesn't work for me. And if you want my opinion on the opening track T-Shirt, well, it's essentially like this album's version of Doll from Colour and the Shape, but much heavier and more aggressive. The transition between this and Run doesn't feel completely natural though, unlike Doll to Monkey Wrench, and the song just doesn't really last long enough to become a standout really, but I do quite enjoy the heavy section of the song, so that's something I do quite enjoy. And then we move on to what is probably the biggest unpopular opinion that I have about this album. The only track I have yet to talk about is The Sky Is a Neighbourhood, the most recent single from the album. And people seem to really like this song, with many reviewers praising it like it's the next big thing or something, with many it saying it's the standout track from this album. Me, on the other hand, I really don't like this track. Now before you grab all your pitchforks, let me just explain why. This song for me is just not good. From almost the second it begins playing, I already have problems with it. First off, I know that Dave Grohl's signature shoutiness to his vocals is what drives many of their songs, but using shouty as hell vocals on what is meant to be a softer ballad style track just doesn't work for me. They can sound pretty forced as a result, especially during the verses, and that's just one of the reasons why I'm just not a fan of this track. The lyrics, again similar to Run, can be very repetitive with the same lines and words just repeated half the time. After listening to this track, I can't stand the line banging on the ceiling anymore. Plus, as a track in general, it just feels really samey and kinda boring at points. It really doesn't go anywhere aside from adding a string section towards the end, and that just bangs in the nail in the coffin of this song. I mean, it's not awful, I mean, instrumentally it's pretty good, and I admire the ambition and effort that got put into this track as a whole, but after listening to it now about 6 or 7 times, it just hasn't improved for me. In fact, it's probably gotten worse. I generally think this is the worst track on the album. I know I'm probably going to get a ton of hate for that, but I really wanted to like this track, guys. I really did, but just too much of this song just doesn't work for me, and that just kind of ruins it. So before I wrap things up, I should probably talk about the production of the album, the thing I was most skeptical about when going in. For me, the production can vary from track to track really. Some tracks work very well with Kirsten's really loud guitar driven moments, but others just don't. And when it doesn't work, the guitars can just completely drown out the other instruments, especially the drums and bass. And that added with the large amounts of reverb on a lot of the tracks and how overwhelming some of the distorted vocals are, can at times make some of the tracks feel a bit overproduced, but yet again some of that is due to the mixing. But the production certainly isn't bad, and tracks like Arrows, Sunday Rain and Screw It, Skies and Neighbourhood are spot on. I just feel that Kirsten was not the best choice for the producer, as this is the first full length hard rock album he has made. So I just feel that bringing in someone else that had more experience with this genre may have been a better idea. Which brings us to the album as a whole. Again, when I went into this album, I was a little skeptical, but at the same time, still very excited for new Foo's material. But even I will have to admit that overall, this was a bit of a disappointing record. Now, do not get me wrong. There are some legitimately great moments on this record, and the effort that the band put into this record to make it the most epic and grand Foo Fighters album is very evident. This album had a lot of potential, but I feel that it missed the mark on many areas that keep it from being an album that truly feels like it's worthy of the Foo Fighters name. It has great tracks, but they all feel sandwiched in between filler and songs that I just can't get into. When I listen to a Foo Fighters record, I want to be given an album that when it finishes makes me want more, but in a good way because you enjoyed it so much. In the past, they have delivered on that, but then some. But when I finished listening to this album, I just ejected the disc and then just stuck it back on the shelf, not feeling too satisfied. This is definitely a one and done album for me. It was perfectly fine and entertaining, and you did enjoy it in some areas, but gives you little reason to go back to it. I'd say wait for a price drop on this one. If you're a Foo Fighters fan, you'll at least like this album, but if you're not, then this isn't exactly the best place to start. Start with these beauties. So with all that in mind, I'm going to give Concrete and Gold by Foo Fighters a 7 out of 10. Shangri-La now.